So what's in those animations is what happens with lynx, especially lynx that are not reproductively active. So females that don't have kittens or males that didn't have a reproductively active female, is when it comes time for spring and summer and they don't have a den or kittens to tend to, a lot of times they take off and do what we term these walkabouts. So they take these big exploratory movements, and it seems like they're just sort of checking out the landscape. And so what you're seeing in these videos are exactly that. These are summertime movements of resident lynx who just didn't have anything to, you know, keep them at home during the summer. And, you know, they take off, head north, and start to explore. So some of them, you know, made it into Wyoming, some of them made it all the way into Montana or Idaho. And what's interesting is a lot of them, you know, spent the summer sort of wandering around and then sort of make their way right back to this, the same drainage, the same home range that they left from, you know, come October, November, before winter hits. And so that's what you're seeing in these videos is various individuals and the big movements that they make. Which is pretty impressive, because for a little cat, you know, for a 20-pound cat, they're very capable of moving a long ways through some pretty incredible places and in places that we don't consider to be lynx habitat at all, really. Yeah, that's a little surprising, you know, just because there is nothing east at all that resembles anything like lynx habitat. And so, you know, it's a little surprising in that respect. But then again, you know, I'm not sure that... you know, they know exactly what's out there when they take off. But those animals were headed sort of out to nowhere, and, you know, nothing good was going to come of that for them. The ones that actually went north, you know, certainly there's patches of good habitat and even other lynx for them to run into up there. So that, you know, makes more sense. I don't know, you know, if the lynx know where they're headed or not. That's interesting to think about. But. Typical home range for lynx is about 75 square kilometers for a reproductively active female. They figure, you know, a little more than 8 kilometers on a side if it's a square kind of thing. And then males are quite a bit bigger than that, maybe 100 to 120 square kilometers. Oftentimes a male will have at least a couple of females within his home range. Canada lynx is a cat. It looks very similar and is very closely related to bobcats, except they're very highly adapted to deep, soft snow winter conditions. So they have real long hind legs and then big feet that sort of act like snowshoes. Okay, so they do really well in deep, soft snow in places where lots of other species just flounder and can't really survive or make a living at all. And they're very tightly tied to snowshoe hares. And so much of their ecology, much of their existence is related to how snowshoe hares are doing and how many hares you have in a particular place. That's really about all that they eat, especially in the winter, is hares. And so they're famous for that. You see these famous lynx and hare cycles in basic ecology textbooks all the time. Anyone who comes through wildlife has seen, you know, those cycles and has heard about the relationship between lynx and hares, and it's no different in Colorado. That's what we found that they eat most of the time in most years, and you know, that's sort of how they exist in their little niche in the world, is that really high elevation spruce fir forest where it snows a lot, you know, deep soft snow. But in the springtime, in the summer, again, if they don't have dens to tend to and kittens to tend to, then that's when they can make some of these longer exploratory movements. And that's what we're seeing in these videos. We have several projects still going with lynx. Obviously, you know, this agency spent a considerable amount of time and effort and money in the late 90s and mid 2000s to reintroduce lynx to the state. So we have several efforts that we've worked on, you know, since then, all related to that. One big thing is we continue to monitor the population. So we've instituted a non-invasive monitoring plan to help us kind of keep tabs on how things are going and how lynx are doing in the state. We continue to do that. Shortly after we declared the reintroduction to be a success is when a lot of these bark beetle outbreaks really started to ramp up in lynx country. And so the question then became, you know, this is a forest dwelling species, you know, what is the impact to lynx and to their primary prey when huge chunks of that overstory is dying off. So we did a fair amount of research to look at that too. CPW sort of focused on the primary prey end of things. And then we collaborated with the Forest Service Rocky Mountain Research Station and looked directly at how lynx were responding to bark beetles as well. Another piece of research we did, again, in collaboration with the Rocky Mountain Research Station, is assisted them in looking at impacts of winter recreation on lynx, because certainly, as we all know, winter recreation is a big thing in Colorado, and it's only getting bigger. And there certainly are places where people like to recreate, where lynx also like to hang out. And so the question there is, how do they do that? Can they partition the landscape, and how well does that work? And what's the impact of all this recreation on lynx? And then most recently, we're also looking at taking a closer look at how management of our national forest impacts snowshoe hare density. And then we know that in turn impacts, how lynx do as well. So we're taking a close look at if, as a manager, you decide to implement some management strategy on a piece of ground, what can you expect then hare density to be like immediately after you do that, a decade after you do that, 2, 3, 4 decades after you do that, even 6 decades out after you do that? What do you expect to happen through time? So is, as they're planning their projects and, planning at kind of a landscape scale and making a mosaic out there of different treatments, what can we expect hare densities to look like in the coming decades? And then that gives us an idea of, how valuable we expect those landscapes to be for lynx too. There's a lot of things I enjoy about lynx. It's such a cool species. I mean, for one, they're rare. I mean, even where they're common and they do well, they're rare. And so there's something intriguing about, species that's out there and it's out there and you can see their tracks in the snow, but you really never see them. I mean, that's sort of an intriguing thing. Just the fact that they're so highly adapted to that environment is pretty amazing. Whenever you get a chance to cut tracks and to start following lynx, I'm always amazed at how well they can traverse that landscape in those snow conditions compared to us. I can have the biggest snowshoes in the world and I'm working hard and sweating hard and I can tell by their gait that they're just cruising along and not really working hard at all. So it's amazing to me how well they can navigate that landscape. And that's a tough place to make a living. I mean, it's deep snow, it is cold. I mean, man, it gets cold up there, and they just seem to do their thing, and they can live. We have lots of lynx in this state that, we know their ages because we put them all out there, and or we found them as kittens. And a lot of them are able to live just fine in Colorado in that kind of a harsh environment for 15 years or more, which is pretty amazing to me.